not to read the Bible, which if we are going to be Bible readers and teachers, we had better understand. But there are also some pretty good reasons to do Bible study. And obviously we're going to have a good sense of that as well. In other words, we are in a battle for the Bible in lots of different respects. We are in a battle to read the Bible in a culture that by and large does not read the Bible. That's part of the battle for the Bible, isn't it? Just to struggle for a certain degree of biblical exposure, biblical literacy, encouragement, nurture, and Bible reading in a culture which tends to erode that for lots of these reasons. A couple of reasons that were not given here, although I think they're alluded to here, is that the Bible stories have a difficult time competing with the much more engaging, existentially interactive, overwhelming narratives around us in the world, such as the movies and television and all the different forms of media, which are really more highly seductive than Bible study is as a rule. And we're competing with that all the time for hearts and minds, aren't we? Why read the Bible if you can go to a movie? It's less gratifying in the existential sense because you have to work harder to read the Bible. Turns out that a lot of the fictions of modern culture are extremely spectator-based. They are, in fact, very authoritarian. When an advertisement tells you you need something in order to be a better person, to be happy, to be successful, that's very authoritarian. It's not asking you if you need it. Advertisements never ask you if you need something, do they? So, turns out that these kinds of discourses are really awash in the culture. They're not irrelevant because they're already deeply internalized by all of us. All of us are influenced by commercial kinds of discourses. Aren't they? Anybody who's not influenced by advertisements or billboards or retail signage? No. Probably the most influential discourse in the culture. That says something about the values of the culture. It's a reflection of the values of the culture. A lot of exclusionary language here, but also the genius of commercial discourse is that it usually can adapt to be inclusionary. Where I come from in Los Angeles, very, very multicultural city, and I understand that it's fairly multicultural as well. In Los Angeles, the retailers are always out for some kind of market share, and so if that means advertising in Spanish or Korean, then that's what is done. And there is a Spanish Yellow Pages. Yellow Pages is the business kind of phone. So, advertisers are quicker to learn about inclusionary language, usually, than religious folk. They're smarter than us because they break things down into consumable bites. They don't bother with too many pieties. They try not to be boring. Anyway, we are always competing in a battle for the Bible against all the other narratives and myths and discourses of the culture. That's the first battle for the Bible, always. Okay? Does that ring true to you? The first battle for the Bible is the battle with all the other narrative traditions that claim or that struggle for our allegiance. And by and large, that's a battle we're not just losing, we've lost in this culture and in the United States. In a poll that one of the major pollsters did a few years ago, years ago in the United States in terms of who do you trust and kind of what discourse do you trust? Church discourse, clergy discourse, Bible discourse came in, I think, around 15, something like that. This is in a culture now where 70% or more of the people in the United States claim that they're Christians and go to church. But as far as what they trust, right, it ranks fairly low. So we've pretty much lost that battle, or are losing it. The other battle for the Bible is with the battle with all the people reading the Bible. Right? It's the other part of the battle. It's a battle, it's a struggle over interpretation, over how to interpret the Bible. And the two ways in which I think we become demoralized is we become so demoralized by this list that we figure this is hopeless. We can't convince anyone to read the Bible. There are just too many other interesting things. So we attempt to do church and minimize Bible study. The other problem is that we become demoralized about the struggle over interpreting the Bible, and we concede the Bible to perhaps our interpretive opponents or our interpretive competitors. And this is something particularly that liberal churches have done, conceding the Bible to the people they call them, the fundamentalists. And so for at least two compelling reasons, we've got a lot of folks trying to be church without the Bible. Problem is, with that, is that we become a church without a story to tell. And if we don't have any story to tell, then on what basis do we compete for market share? Well, it's maybe how entertaining our liturgy is, how heroic our social justice work is. What are some other reasons we can attract market share in the church if we're not telling a story? Well, we can adopt some other kind of stories that are maybe seem more contemporary, but of course they go in and out of fashion so quickly that we tend to get ourselves into trouble that way. We can become counseling agencies. A lot of churches have tried doing that to keep their market share. Well, what I'd like to suggest this morning as far as this battle for the Bible business goes is that in those two realms of the battle for the Bible, we can only prevail if we are willing to stake a claim somewhere. We're going to have to decide whether these stories are worth struggling for. I mean, we're really going to have to make that decision. If we are ambivalent about that, whoever we are, in our parachurch organization, in our church, parish, in our university movement, in our social justice movement, whatever it is, whoever we are, we're going to have to decide really whether we trust these stories. Because if we are ambivalent about that, that will show up all over the place. And of course, that raises lots of questions about how do we trust? Do we trust in this kind of authoritarian fashion? We'll talk more about that. And we're going to have to rediscover a form of Bible study that is engaging and relevant and gives us some of that ground on which to stand. In other words, we're going to have to first demonstrate to ourselves that the Bible is worth reading. And then we're going to have to constantly engage the other people reading the Bible by not conceding the Bible to them, but actually arguing the Bible with them. That's always been the case, friends. In the biblical tradition, renewal movements within that tradition always center around arguing about what the tradition means. So the prophets in the Hebrew Bible are constantly constantly arguing with courts and kings and other prophets, who they call false prophets, about what the Bible means and what their scriptural tradition means, right? And what God is saying. And Jesus is always arguing with the scribes and the Pharisees and the Sadducees and his own disciples about what the Bible says. Have you never read? Asks Jesus with a twinkle in his eye to the teachers of the Bible. This is what the apostolic tradition did. It always started by engaging the other interpreters of the tradition. So we're going to have to, at least as a provisional kind of thing, we're going to have to say, we're going to try to take a stand here on this story, and then we're going to have to do it, and in the doing of it, we're going to have to engage in all those battles for the Bible. If we don't think there's a reason to do it, we won't do it, and that will be communicated even through our professionalism, simply by omission. Now, I assume that most of you are here because you want to engage in that battle for the Bible. So I don't want to say a whole lot more talking about Bible study. I'd like to actually do some Bible study. But I always think it's important to locate ourselves in kind of history and in the culture to understand where we are and what's working against us and what's working for us and that kind of thing. Now, let me make some suggestions that I think can build on some of the strengths and hedge against some of the problems that we've identified. And throw out some hypotheses here, and then we'll kind of work with those provisionally to see if they work. One is that, let's start with a provisional assumption, trying to be very non-authoritarian here. Come from California, you know. Everybody's got to feel comfortable with it. Let's start with a provisional assumption that the Bible is a people's book. That is, it belongs to regular folk. It was produced by regular folk, about regular folk, on behalf of regular folk. Those are three distinct propositions there. That is, it is really, truly one of the only texts that we have from antiquity that has regular people as the primary subjects. This is not, by and large, a book about elite people. There are kings in here, but mostly the kings in here are severely criticized. These are not court documents that praise the powerful. They're about fishermen and bleeding women and regular folk. And even if they are produced by literate people, these are literate people who, in most cases, took stands alongside regular people and so wrote on their behalf. So let's start with the provisional assumption that the Bible belongs to the people. Now, that may seem like a rather obvious statement, but if you look around at how the Bible is handled, it mostly is perceived as belonging to a clerical class and a professional scholastic class. This is as true in evangelical and fundamental churches as it is in liberal churches. That there is a special expert class, whether that's the street preacher who has kind of ordained him or herself, or whether it's the PhD in biblical studies who has the guild mark of approval. In either case, these are folks who are going to tell us what it means and who are going to use that authority to accrue social power to themselves. The Bible has, by and large, been captured by this elite class. Partly because it is not an obvious text. But then again, even obvious texts are produced by elite classes for elite interests. Let's go back to the deodorant commercial. It's not a complicated text to decipher, however mythical it may be. But it's produced by an elite class for an elite class. Would you agree with that? I mean, after all, who's making money off of yogurt? Not you and me. So, we need to find a way to re-enfranchise the people, to find modes of empowerment so that people can recapture their story. Now, this is a very old kind of strategy in the church. There's some very direct correlation to church renewal and revolutionary Christianity and that kind of thing with the recovery of the story by the people. Something about the Protestant Reformation, if I remember correctly. But even before that, every renewal movement has been characterized by a direct reappropriation of this story. Every single renewal in the history of the church. Right up until today with the base communities in the third world, which are really doing nothing more but nothing less than sitting around and reading the Bible. And out of that, participating in all kinds of amazing social struggle in Africa and Asia and Latin America and the Pacific Islands. So, provisional assumption number one, Bible belongs to the people. The people need to somehow take it back. Provisional assumption number two, in order to do that, we will have to work with what the people know rather with what they don't know, what we don't know. That is, we will have to become convinced again that the Bible is in fact a popular. Not just that it belongs to the people, but that it is in fact a people's book. It is accessible to people. It is intelligible to regular people. That is, specially set aside either for clerical reasons or academic reasons or Pentecostal reasons. It is accessible to all of us. And how do we do that? Or how do we rediscover that? And so the third provisional assumption, and this is going to be a shocker, is that the Bible is a story. Well, of course, you'll be quick to say, no, it's a collection of stories. Sure. Sure, it's a collection of stories. But the collection of stories are all in dialogue with what one might call a meta-narrative or a storyline that runs through this collection of stories. The task of Bible reading being to discover the storyline. It belongs to the people. It is and should be accessible to the people. And here we're talking in the realm of story. Now you see where I'm going with this, don't you? I would make a claim that because the Bible is a story, that is precisely what makes it accessible to people. And it has been the loss of the role of story, or we could say the loss, we could say the replacement, that has been a big factor in a lot of the alienating things that we listed. That in general, our culture has atrophied as a culture organized around popular storytelling. That is, storytelling told by people, about people, for people. You following me? The storyteller. Who are the storytellers in our society today?
The movie makers.
The movie makers. Is that a popular class? A popular class, the movie makers?
They promote themselves.
Promoting themselves doesn't make one popular in the sense of a widespread class. I mean, it's movie makers are an elite class, but they know how to make popular narrative. That is, narrative that is widely consumed. But of course, they've got to convince people to that these stories are worth seeing. So there's a huge marketing apparatus that goes along with the movies. Movies are very different than telling your child a story at bedtime. How many of you still do that? No, raise your hands. How many of you still do that?
He's grown.
Gathering folks around a campfire and telling a story, and an elite class of entertainment manufacturing. And we live in a culture where today entertainment is an industry. It's not something that people do to be human. It is something, although I think that's why people go to movies, because they want to have a story to listen to, but it has become a professionalized, elitist market. Who are some other influential storytellers?
Newsreaders.
Newsreaders. Newsreaders and writers? News editors, is that what you're talking about?
No, I'm talking about the ones who tell us the news on the radio or the television.
Okay, so the electronic journalists. Sure. They're telling us stories, aren't they? Not necessarily telling us the whole story. Because there is no such thing as telling the whole story. We only ever tell part of the story. That's part of the limitations of human discourse. And electronic journalism, particularly TV and radio, but we could add print journalism there, print media, is also become a highly professionalized class that is actually beginning to become indistinguishable from the entertainment industry. Thus, the evening news, at least in the United States, is moving towards what we call infotainment. You were going to say something?
Governments and politicians as well.
Yeah, politicians are still the great orators, still the great storytellers, but the microphones are louder now. That's the difference. I mean, politicians are still great orators, but they have much more access to more households. They are bigger, and they too have become part of the entertainment industry. How? Why? Because you have to now have a persona to be a politician. You have to be bigger than life. You have to be marketed. You have to be shown how to be mediagenic, media friendly, to be a politician. I mean, at least in the United States, maybe that's not so much true here, but it's probably moving in that direction. You wanted to say something? Who's we?
Well, as we encounter other people, as we encounter members of our family groupings, we are the prime storytellers. I think your whole tradition is still very powerful.
All right. Clearly, regular folks still tell stories. No question about it. We all do it every single day. We were doing it from bloody 6:15 in the morning today. Some of us around about 16 cups of coffee. Telling stories about this and that, and sure, we still do it all the time. But the problem is that the space of what we might call popular oral culture has become increasingly restricted to private space. Our homes, a restaurant, it's domestic space. The public space is largely dominated by the storytelling industries or the media. And as a general rule, would you agree with that? Anybody want to sharply disagree? I mean, I think that's where we are. And that's, again, important to say. Because when we do Bible story, when we approach the Bible as a set of stories, we are going to have to be drawing off a tradition that still exists, is still used, but is in itself in a struggle over how to tell a story, right? So we're not just battling for the Bible, we're battling over how human beings tell stories, on what terms they tell stories, who owns the stories, how the stories operate, in whose interest, and so on. Yes.
I think there is one point of disagreement, and maybe, I don't know, a gender issue. I think that storytelling is still very much alive in some smaller communal groups, which sometimes tend to be more women because they've been encouraged to talk more about. Now, that, I could be wrong there, but my own experience is...
No, I don't think you're wrong at all. I think, I'm agreeing with you, I think popular storytelling and oral tradition do exist, but I think the space is shrinking in which it does exist. It's shrinking under the onslaught of very powerful storytelling, which I would characterize as coming from the top down. This is top-down storytelling. The storytelling you're talking about is kind of bottom-up storytelling. Carol?
I think for my teenage daughters, their storytellers today are the popular band.
Yeah, music. We really need to say music is very, very important. Popular culture really.
Sport.
Yeah, sport is certainly a kind of a narrative tradition, isn't it? Certainly the agonist drama of the good guys falling wood and the bad guys Hawthorne.
One of the few areas where we get a lot of stories that are intensely personal and small scale is in the area of war reporting.
Which report?
War reporting, yeah. You look anywhere in the world today, stories are extracted from that which almost invariably fail to address the real issues on that particular war.
Yeah.
But give a sense that almost the war is inevitable, it's part of the whole it's a huge.
Yeah, that's what you would call then the editorial angle, is what we might call the narrative strategy of the dominant media. All stories articulate a point of view, what we could call a narrative strategy. And all these forms of top-down storytelling are not just entertaining, they're articulating a narrative strategy which is correlated to certain real social, economic, and political interests. All we're doing here, folks, is a little bit of cultural anthropology on our own culture. We are trying to understand that we do not, in fact, live in a rational culture where there is truth and fiction. That's the myth of rational scientific, technocratic society. We live in a world where stories battle with stories for hearts and minds. Human culture has always been that way. It will always be that way. Therefore, we, whoever we are, need to decide which stories, on what terms, for whose interests.
I basically agree with you about shrinking space, but I think there are four requires, and I'm thinking of the huge women in oral history, I'm thinking of Aboriginal groups using technology to get their stories across to their own kids and others. Thinking of kids writing stories about their families on computers. You know, there's things where the new stuff and the old stuff come together, and it's
quite exciting. There's lots of ways in which we can battle to open that space up again for storytelling and from, if you will, from the bottom up. That's what I want to suggest we ought to be about, is struggling to open that space. And I want to suggest that these stories can help us do that. But we first have to appreciate that we've got a narrative tradition. And most of us who have been seminary trained were trained that we don't have a narrative tradition, we have a doctrinal tradition. That is this series of abstract propositions that people must assent to with very little narrative value, or insofar as it has narrative value, that is of secondary value. And I want to suggest that that has been one of the ways in which we have domesticated or allowed our tradition to become domesticated in a culture which is trying to replace these stories with other stories. And one of the ways to become involved in the battle for the Bible and the battle for the culture as a whole is to recover our own narrative tradition, because in so doing, we will accomplish, I believe, a number of things. First of all, we will connect our tradition back to our people. We will begin to redistribute power in our churches from the clerical scholarly class back to the people who will be enfranchised in the process of reading stories, because they can read stories. It's precisely because people still know how to read stories, still know how to tell stories, and still know how to interpret stories, that we can do Bible study in church. And in so doing that, we will also be helping folks not only reconnect to a story tradition, but also to become more literate in all the forms of storytelling that swirl around us and compete for our hearts and minds. One of the big problems today is because of this top-down entertainment culture ethos is that we have all become spectators who are not critically interacting with the story and storylines that we're getting. What we do at best is become cynical or disillusioned. For example, with politicians' narratives. Oh, can't trust the politicians. Well, that's fine. But what are you going to replace those political stories with? People are extremely credulous when it comes to journalism by and large. Most people still believe they're getting the straight story and most of the story from the free press. People are incredibly credulous believing of commercial storytelling, even though we fancy that we're not. That is, that it shapes our hearts and minds in ways that are entirely unconscious to us. So if we bring some of these storytelling skills to consciousness and exercise them in the alternative space of the church and community, if we thereby also help rebuild community, we will be using tools that will carry over to the other cultural traditions around us. So recovering story in the church is going to help us connect to the people and empower the people in a critical interaction with the culture as a whole. At least as a provisional proposition, we can see if this actually works in the doing of it.
Us, that is,
see and that are interested enough, taken enough by this story, transformed enough by the story, that we want to re-narrate it in some meaningful sense in our lives, and so we come out of the circle of the story differently than how we went in. Now, a lot of people obviously never get past the spontaneous reading. Most scholars and elite classes get stuck in the critical reading, where there's so much distance between the reader and the text that the text can never really speak about the world. And what we want to try to do is go through a process so that the story can read us. Anyway, that's just a simple model. We can come back to that. What I want to do is read the story. So everybody's got a Bible. There's only one good kind of Bible, and that's an open one. In Mark chapter 1, let's go to Mark 1. 45 through 36. No, let's not do that. Let's start. We all look like an eager bunch, so let's start in 121. In other words, let's go from Jesus' first entry into a synagogue to his next entry into a synagogue, which forms a kind of a narrative sequence. Framed by two synagogue episodes. And if we get through all of this, you'll have done your Bible obligation for probably the rest of the century. All right. Let us read this bit of text. It's really not all that much.
Jesus and his disciples came to the town of Capernaum. And on the next Sabbath, Jesus went to the synagogue and began to teach. The people who heard him were amazed at the way he taught, for he wasn't like the teachers of the law. Instead, he taught with authority. Just then, a man with an evil spirit in him came into the synagogue and screamed, "What do you want to do with me, Jesus of Nazareth? Are you here to destroy us? I know who you are. You are God's holy messenger." Jesus ordered the spirit, "Be quiet and come out of the man." The evil spirit shook the man's heart, gave a loud scream, and came out of him. The people were all so amazed that they started saying to one another, "What is this? Is it some kind of new teaching? This man has authority to give orders to the evil spirits, and they obey him." And so the news about Jesus spread quickly everywhere in the province of Galilee.
Jesus and his disciples, including James and John, left the synagogue and went straight to the home of Simon and Andrew. Simon's mother-in-law was sick in bed with a fever, and as soon as Jesus arrived, he was told about her. He went to her, took her by the hand, and helped her up. The fever left her, and she began to wait on them. After the sun had set and evening had come, people brought to Jesus all the sick and those who had demons. All the people of the town gathered in front of the house. Jesus healed many who were sick with all kinds of diseases and drove out many demons. He would not let the demons stay with him, because they knew who he was. Very early the next morning, long before daylight, Jesus got up and left the house. He went out of the town to a lonely place where he prayed. But Simon and his companions went out searching for him. And when they found him, they said, "Everyone is looking for you." But Jesus answered, "We must go on to the other villages around here. I have to preach in them also, because that is why I came." So he travelled all over Galilee, preaching in the synagogues and driving out demons.
Carol, before you begin, realizing we are videoing this, can you turn the video to each reader? Is that possible?
Yep.
Yeah, let's try to do that. So we'll give you a minute to turn over to Carol, and then we'll have each reader on camera. We've got a ways to go through this text, and that'll help our video audience. Beaming live over 40 countries, I hope you know.
A man suffering from a dreaded skin disease came to Jesus, knelt down, and begged him for help. "If you want to," he said, "you can make me clean." Jesus was filled with pity and reached out and touched him. "I do want to," he answered. "Be clean." At once the disease left the man and he was clean. Then Jesus spoke sternly to him and sent him away at once, after saying to him, "Listen, don't tell anyone about this, but go straight to the priest and let him examine you. Then in order to prove to everyone that you are cured, offer the sacrifice that Moses ordered." But the man went away and began to spread the news everywhere. Indeed, he talked so much that Jesus could not go into a town publicly. Instead, he stayed out in lonely places, and people came to him from everywhere.
Again entered Capernaum. The people heard that he had come home. So many gathered that there was no room left, not even outside the door, and he preached the word to them. Some men came, bringing to him a paralytic carried by four of them. Since they could not get him to Jesus because of the crowd, they made an opening in the roof above Jesus, and after digging through it, lowered the mat, and the paralyzed man was lying on. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Now some teachers of the law were sitting there thinking to themselves, "Why does this fellow talk like that? He's blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone?" Immediately Jesus knew in his spirit that this was what they were thinking in their hearts, and he said to them, "Why are you thinking these things? Which is easier, to say that to the paralytic, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Get up, take your mat, and walk'? But that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins," he said to the paralytic, "I tell you, get up, take your mat, and go home." He got up, took his mat, and walked out in full view of all of them. This amazed everyone, and they praised God, saying, "We've never seen anything like this."
He taught them. As he was walking along, he saw Levi, son of Alphaeus, sitting at the tax booth. And he said to him, "Follow me." And he got up and followed him. And as he sat down at dinner in Levi's house, many tax collectors and sinners were also sitting with Jesus and his disciples, for there were many who followed him. When the scribes of the Pharisees saw that he was eating with sinners and tax collectors, they said to his disciples, "Why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners?" When Jesus heard this, he said to them, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. I have come to call not the righteous, but sinners."
Once, when John's disciples and the Pharisees were keeping a fast, some people came and asked him, "Why is it that John's disciples and the disciples of the Pharisees are fasting, but yours are not?" Jesus replied, "Can you expect the bridegroom's friends to fast while the bridegroom is with them? As long as he is with them, there can be no fasting. But the time will come when the bridegroom will be taken away from them. That will be the time for them to fast. No one sews a patch of unshrunk cloth onto an old garment. If he does, the patch tears away from it, the new from the old, and leaves a bigger hole. No one puts new wine into old wineskins. If he does, the wine will burst the skins, and then wine and skins are both lost. New wine goes into fresh skins.
Jesus was walking through some cornfields on the Sabbath. As his disciples walked along with him, they began to pick the ears of corn. So the Pharisees said to Jesus, "Look, it's against our law for your disciples to do that on the Sabbath." Jesus answered, "Have you never read what David did that time when he needed something to eat? He and his men were hungry, so he went into the house of God and ate the bread offered to God. This happened when Abiathar was the high priest. According to our law, only the priest may eat this bread. But David ate it, and even gave it to his men." And Jesus concluded, "The Sabbath was made for the good of man. Man was not made for the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath."
Then Jesus went back to the synagogue, where there was a man who had a paralyzed hand. Some people were there who wanted to accuse Jesus of doing wrong. They watched him closely to see whether he would heal the man on the Sabbath. Jesus said to the man, "Come up here to the front." Then he asked the people, "What does our law allow us to do on the Sabbath? To help or to harm? To save a man's life or to destroy it?" They did not say a thing. Jesus was angry as he looked around at them, but at the same time he felt sorry for them because they were so stubborn and wrong. Then he said to the man, "Stretch out your hand." He stretched it out, and it became well again. So the Pharisees left the synagogue and met at once with some members of Herod's party, and they made plans to kill Jesus.
Thank you. These will be the texts that we work on today. It is always good, however, to remind ourselves as we enter into the circle of story, the kinds of stories that compete for our hearts and minds, because they shape how we read stories. There is something in us that kind of tunes out when we read the Bible, no matter how committed to it we are, because we have actually been socialized by the narratives that we hear most often. And the Bible is the Bible, and it's a little bit idiosyncratic, it's a little bit strange, it's a little bit holy, we're not sure quite how we should handle it, it should only be preached, it has some magical significance, all of these fairly strange attitudes we have toward the Bible. So it's always good to start the process of reading by actually reading texts from our own culture. So I want to just take two quick examples as a way of warming up. Well, I'll take one from your context and one from mine. I'm going to walk around this and then I'll bring it up to the camera to show you. This is an advertisement taken from one of your popular magazines. It is an advertisement. I can't say it that way. I'm trying to, though. For advertisement. For Komatsu, which is a heavy machinery company, large multinational. And the picture shows a suit lifting up the curtain of the world and looking at your community. Nicely pictured as a kind of a English style garden kind of community, of course, with a nice Komatsu crane located conveniently in the middle of it, helping you to dig your sewers or remodel your house or doing whatever it is that you need to do to improve your community. And the text says, "Think locally, act globally." Right? Ever
seen anything like this before?
Why don't you hold that up for the camera so I can get a good shot at that? Just hold it right in front of the video.
Can you get that? Yeah. This is the kind of a text that we will consume in nanoseconds as we're flipping through a magazine, or it comes up on the television, or we see it driving at 100 kilometers an hour through downtown Melbourne, as my friend John does. It's a powerful text. It's a narrative text. It's a symbolic text. What do you make of it? What do you make of it?
Well, it turns around we're familiar with the opposite of that. I think why will we act locally?
Well, where does that slogan come from?
That's from the environmental
movement. From the environmental movement, and how environmental friendly do you think Komatsu is? It's a serious question. Is there a war of myths going on here? Is there a struggle between stories about the world? Think globally, act locally, slogan of the environmental movement. Think locally, act globally, slogan of the multinational engineering movement. That's a movement too, isn't it? With its stories. High mythology here?
Drawing of the symbolism Atlas holding up the world.
Yeah, that's good. That's very sharp. I haven't seen that. There is a little bit of the Atlas motif there, isn't it? Holding up the world. But at the same time, there's a motif of kind of looking through the world or behind the world, drawing up the curtain. See, symbols are wonderfully elastic. There are multi-layers of meaning. That's why people like them, by the way. And that's why they're so powerful. Is because there's never just one meaning. The truth is always deeper than just one meaning. Yes?
It's moving from darkness into light.
Moving from darkness into light, that's good. There's some archetypes, darkness to light, Atlas holding up the world, Atlas as a modern businessman, Atlas peering into your community with designs in mind. What do you reckon? Whoever's got the picture is on a stage?
No. Standing in space.
Standing in space, right? Standing nowhere but omnipresent. Yes?
There's also Apollo Lee.
Yeah, there really is. With his back to you, kind of drawing you. The function of that is the actual positioning of the central character, right? That's graphic design. Graphic design is one of the dominant discourses of the 20th century. Some studies have been done about that and how powerful graphic design is in shaping our hearts and minds by positioning and posturing and gesturing and layout and all the very powerful ways in which the story is told, not by content, but by
image,
by design, by form. And there's the first rule of learning how to read story, that form is as important as content. Alright? You gotta look at how something is told as well as just what is told. Most of you were talking about the what. This is what it says, but a couple of you pointing out actually the design, the structure of the text. Very important. It will also be important in reading the Bible.
So it looks very corporate. And as opposed to, say, the environmental image, which is very much grassroots, sort of Jesus and
image. Yep, so there's no doubt about where this text stands in the war of myths. Mm.
Isn't
it
lifting up
our
image of the Garden of Eden?
Yeah, image of the world lifting up, and in any case, it's a curtain to be raised and lowered at will. Yes?
Very clever.
I think it's very clever.
Classic, and therefore, somebody who's grown up with think globally and locally, there's a sense of interest, sort of perversion.
There's a sense of that someone has expropriated my discourse. Well, welcome to the war of myths. That's what people do. They rip off each other's texts to serve specific interests. That is how narrative functions. And everybody does it. So it's not a matter of are you doing it, it's a matter of which interests you are doing it for. Or whose interests.
Is that the global village imagery?
Yeah. Very much here. Global village.
Nothing.
Right? Map of the globe, little picture of a village. But what is universal to both the globe and the village? Komatsu! You see, very powerful stuff. The people who do this, yeah, go ahead.
I was just going to say, it's a prime example, I think, of a hidden agenda.
Or not so hidden, maybe.
Well, yeah, but I mean, there's this little bit of earth moving equipment down in the corner. But the whole picture is something else.
That's what we can call mystification. Setting up a kind of a sacred universe with lots of symbols that will be invoking certain responses in the audience and putting them at the service of one's narrative strategy, which is to get us to not just be consumers of Komatsu products, but probably at this level of sophisticated narrative, since most of us aren't buying, what do you call that machine anyway here? I don't know what you call it. Bulldozer, whatever it is.
Excavator,
okay, let's call it an excavator. Good kind of capitalist image. Since most of us aren't in the market of buying excavators, Komatsu is competing for our allegiance or our sense of acceptance of Komatsu. Komatsu is really concerned with your village and is acting globally to make your village a better place, which is why that excavator is kind of toddling down Main Street of the village.
It's a very English village.
Yeah.
Which is almost put into a white Caucasian dominant.
Oh yeah, sure, there's very definite class interests at stake here. I mean, it's not an African village, but then again, it's market specific. This isn't an Australian magazine. Well, we could go on. It's kind of hidden, but it's not so hidden because it's not hard for us to deconstruct. But of course, when you're zooming by these at a great speed without taking the extra 2 minutes to see what's going on, somehow these things are working on our consciousness. Texts like this bombard us day in, day out, constantly. Alright? This is the world we live in. Alright? Well, that's commercial media, and we all know commercial media is all about huckstering, and you can't hardly trust it. So let's turn over to the magazines, the news magazines, which will tell us about how the world really is. Time magazine, you know it. It's a popular American news magazine. Here is a text which I didn't have to research. I just was doing this workshop one day in Albuquerque about 5 years ago and needed a text to do this exercise. And I always like to take a text from the daily paper or something, so I opened up the magazine. Boom! Here it was. This is from October 1988. This is a story about the launching of the first space shuttle after the Challenger disaster and the great setback that represented for the U.S. space program. I know it's hard for you to read, but I think you can see the essential elements of this particular journalistic text. We have two photographs, very important convention in journalism, how you place the photograph, what you show and what you don't show in the photograph. We have the layout, we have the headlines, subheadings, the text, right? All of the conventions of journalistic discourse at the level of magazine. Why don't you hold that up for the camera? Text, the magic is back. This is in the science part of the magazine, all right? This is our rational culture at work again. The magic is back. Since you're holding it, why don't you read the subheading, the subtitle? Put your glasses on there, and then you can hold it back up for the camera.
On a thundering
cliff. Stand up and read it loudly. This is a loud subheading here.
On a thundering pillar of fire,
discovery carries the nation's hopes aloft again.
Funny, I thought we were in the science page, but I guess we're on the religion page. Well, probably we don't have to spend a whole lot of time on this except to recognize that this is how stories are told. This is how events are interpreted. There is no such thing as direct access to history or to experience. There is only the struggle over how to interpret what happens. And in this particular interpretive text, we have what particularly going on with the pictures here, the way that these pictures are juxtaposed.
Worship, awe, adoration.
Yeah. It's really powerful stuff, this.
Also, the individual in both of them is not people, there's just one person.
Sure. This strengthens the dominant discourse of individuality. It gives the sense in a mass culture that I has meaning. That is the genius of capitalist culture, is it keeps telling you that you matter, primarily as a consumer, that you have a choice, that your business counts, that what you think really matters, that how you vote really matters. And this is very strongly reinforced day in, day out in all kinds of discourses, and this is one of them. So this woman, who may actually have just been, what really may have been happening in this picture, she may have been going, oh, I just locked my keys in my car. Although it's likely that she is in fact responding to the takeoff of the Challenger. But the juxtapositioning here clearly is one of adoration. No question about it. That would be the most obvious, spontaneous way of reading this text. And here's the pillar of fire, and here is technology as divine, and this is reinforced by, and here's the way that American journalism tries to cover its bases. You've got the pagan discourse, the magic is back, and you've got the religious discourse, the thundering pillar of fire, and then you've got the patriotic discourse, bearing the nation's hopes aloft. It's a little something for everybody. All right, that's the news. Why do this? We do this in part because we're starting with what we know. That's very important. To remind ourselves that we are all very culturally literate, we know how to decode very complicated and very sophisticated texts. Would you agree that these are complicated and sophisticated? I mean, imagine, of course they don't seem that way to you, you understood them like that, but imagine 2,000 years from now trying to decode these texts. Maybe without knowing anything about the history of the Challenger disaster, or not knowing anything about the slogan, think globally, act locally, or what Komatsu is, be very tough, wouldn't it? So you are all cultural insiders, you are culturally literate, you have an extremely sophisticated sense of narrative. That's important to start with because people are very literate. We have an innate narrative competence, is the way certain scholars refer to it. Narrative competence. We know how to tell stories. We know how to decode symbols when they are drawn from the stock of our culture. You with me so far? It's always a good warm-up exercise because it's starting with a place that we're familiar with. And it reminds us that when we come up against texts that have a certain amount of narrative sophistication, that in which structure really does determine content, in which symbols are elastic and have many possible references, that's okay. Happens in our culture. It would be plausible that that could have happened in biblical culture. That's not usually how we go to the Bible. We go to the Bible thinking something very simplistic or very abstract, if anything. So, what we're going to do here is we're going to take these eight stories, these eight episodes, and we're going to break up into small groups, and I'm going to give each small group an assignment that will work about 15 minutes. First of all, determine the three basic elements of narrative, right? You all know what they are. Character, plot, and setting. To tell a story, you need a story world, right? The global curtain and the local village, the thundering pillar of fire and the adoring worshiper. You need a story world, you need a setting, you need a plot, something to happen, and you need characters, somebody to do something. Right? Very basic, anybody can do this. This is not rocket science, no pun intended. So, identify the setting of these stories, of these episodes, identify who the characters are, and when it comes to plot, it's not just what happens. Try to see if you can identify the essential conflict. Who is struggling with who? Oftentimes there will be more than one conflict. What's the basic tension? See if you can identify it. All right, so each group in each episode will try to identify the setting or settings, the essential conflict or conflicts in the plot and the subplot, and who are the basic characters. And you might want to do, in identifying the characters, you might want to talk a little bit about who in the story seems to have the power and who is struggling for the power. And who has high status, who has low status, and in the plot, does that change? Is this clear? Pretty straightforward, isn't it? And finally, after doing steps 1, 2, and 3, I want you to be sure and see if you find any structure to the way the story is told. I want you to see if there are any reference to any other stories, right? In the Komatsu text, wherever it's gone, there's an allusion to a slogan from the environmental movement. That's called, in academic circles, intertextuality. What it means is one story referring to another story. In the New Testament, in the Gospels, there's one particular story or set of stories that are constantly being alluded to. What do you reckon? Hebrew Bible, that's right. Constantly drawing, alluding, little side winks, and often explicit quotations. See if you can catch it. That's a little hard for our audiences because we are not very biblically literate, and so we don't catch the side winks and the allusions quite as spontaneously as we caught the allusion to an environmental movement slogan. That's why Bible study is work, because it demands, it assumes a certain literacy that we really don't possess. This is a cross-cultural exercise. That's why it is Bible study. So see if you can see the allusions, the citations to older stories, and see if you can find certain words or phrases that, based on your knowledge of the entire narrative of Mark, might be recurring, which what is called narrative symbolics. In other words, if the notion of people being blind, which doesn't occur in this sequence, but occurs, oh no, let's take one that does. For example, the group that's going to deal with this text, hardness of heart. Well, there's a good example of something that both alludes to an older story, but also is going to be reappropriated by Mark and used throughout this narrative at very strategic points. See if you can plot out some of the places that it reappears in Mark, if you have enough knowledge of Mark. These are the kinds of things that we can do in small groups to get to handle the text, to really see how it's working. See if we can get a sense of this narrative sequence as a whole, right? Because all stories are made up of episodes. And each episode tells a story. And then the way that the episodes are strung together further develops the storyline. And then the sum total of the narrative sequence is also telling a broader story. And then, of course, you've got a string of narrative sequences. Now, how do you think... on what basis did I divide up some of these episodes, do you think? Just generally speaking. On what basis does one define an episode?
Contextual, different places, different contexts.
Right, different settings.
Something gets resolved.
Right, a plot resolution of some kind. and change of character. Those are the three signals. Sometimes it's just one, sometimes it's a combination thereof. Not all of these are really intact episodes. For example, this is actually a couple of episodes. I think this is the only one that is that I threw together a couple of episodes. The rest of these are pretty much intact. All right, a number of the groups here, so I can try to keep them straightened. Let's just talk about the settings and see if we can get a sense of the journey as a whole here. Group number one, that's this group, right? What is the setting of this first episode?
Synagogue, Sabbath, Capernaum. In a sense, Jesus had just come there.
Right.
It was a teaching center, it was a congregation. He was an itinerant on someone else's path.
Okay. So here it is, a synagogue. Remember, setting is both space and time. Oftentimes, in many episodes, the time is indeterminate. When we're told, it's usually important. In fact, it's always important. Here's another rule of thumb in narrative. Everything's there for a reason. Every detail is there for a reason. The author is in control of his or her material. Always. Every brush stroke, every piece of that advertisement, it's all there for a reason. And so there are no throwaway details in this story. Did you notice kind of a neat closure in this particular episode in terms of the setting? What was that? Right? The news spread. Where does the episode open? How does it open? Literally entering into the synagogue, and the episode closes when? When they leave the synagogue. See, it's real simple. See, this, what we're trying to do is pay attention to simple details. They enter the synagogue, and they exit the synagogue. You know, think a little bit like a director or a producer. How would you stage this? How would you enact this? Mark will often be giving stage directions, which are, in fact, directions on how to read the narrative, right? So they enter the synagogue, they exit the synagogue. Group number two? Right. Okay. You had a little bit more complex of a task. What did you find in terms of just the setting?
The setting is that they come from the synagogue to Peter's family home.
All right. So into a family home. Good.
They stay there the night. Jesus leaves in the morning to a deserted place. They search for him and find him and then tell him basically that they have to go preaching throughout Galilee, and they go out throughout Galilee.
All right. The first mini episode takes place in a family home. You say a day and a night. How do you know that? Let's let this group do its work.
In the morning, it starts to make fun.
All right, any other time indicator in your episode?
The evening at sundown, they brought to him.
At sundown, that's a time indicator. Sun went down. What happens when the sun goes down? Gets dark, right?
That's pretty stuff, isn't it?
What day was the previous episode?
Beginning.
What happens when the sun goes down?
Sabbath.
Sabbath is over? Significant. All right? So, sun goes down. Just doesn't get dark. Something symbolic changes if you're a Jew. Sabbath is over. Morning, Jesus gets up, goes out into a barren place. The word here is wilderness. Have we, based on your knowledge of Mark, have you seen that space before? Where have you seen it?
Who is crying?
Everybody's going to get their chance here, folks. Let's give everybody a chance. In the temptations. So Jesus went out and was tempted in the wilderness. What else happened in the wilderness? Voice cried in the wilderness. In fact, where did the story start? The wilderness. Interesting. In fact, where did Israel start? In the wilderness. All right, cool. So, not in insignificant space. Okay. So, home, wilderness, and then then kind of a directive toward where in particular? Where is Jesus supposed to go preach?
Galilee.
In?
Galilee.
Synagogues.
In the synagogues. All right? So that's kind of a generalized statement, isn't it? Specific episode, general statement. This is the story of an exorcism in a synagogue. And this statement tells us, was this a unique practice?
No.
According to your text, no. This was a ongoing practice of being in synagogues, teaching, exercising, healing. All right? So, we've gone from the synagogue to the home, from the home to the wilderness. We have a generalized statement that that is a pattern. And where's group number three? All right.
Well, our setting is vague in the sense that it is someplace where they are alone.
Right. It's an indeterminate space, right. That's right.
You feel that they are alone, it's one-on-one, and it's some place where a leper can go.
Yeah, good, good.
And it's not where the priest is because Jesus sent this person to the priest, so
right.
It's some distance.
So we can perhaps say that this indeterminate space is somehow, let's call it a safe for lepers.
Okay.
Safe, good, Carol. All right.
Then, that when the leper is healed, he goes everywhere.
Right. Where is he dispatched?
He is dispatched to the synagogue. The priest.
All right, we're probably given the fact that he's going to see a priest, probably to
Jerusalem.
To the temple, to the priestly site, which if he's going to offer sacrifices, is probably the temple, or at least implied. So let's call that an implied temple site. But in fact, where does he go?
Everywhere else. But
everywhere else. So maybe he's going on this same circuit that Jesus is going on. Who knows? And the result of that?
Jesus is forced to go to the lonely place again.
Driven back out into the wilderness. That is, he specifically cannot go where?
The city.
Cannot go to cities, right? So we've got a stricture that Jesus can't go into cities because of something that happened here. See, these are details, folks. Details usually that we'll just kind of throw away. But the details are there because they're trying to tell a story. And the story, in this instance, is a story about space and the politics of space. Where you can go, where you can't go, what's safe space, what's threatening space. In other words, it's about a world that's a real world just like ours, where power is distributed in a certain way, and some spaces are safer than other spaces. So we're starting to get an idea of this world. Group four, where are you? All right, then back.
The setting for us is that he is said to have re-entered Capernaum.
Yes, right.
Capernaum.
Yep.
And he's in a home.
And he's in a home.
And in fact, he's stated that he's at home.
At home. So possibly, again, a family home of some kind.
Well, he was, the people had said that he had come home.
He had come home. So this is a, some kind of familiar home. Let's call it a familiar home. All right. Very good. You notice a pattern developing here? Okay. All right. Next episode, group five.
He went out again, so he's outside. And he's walking along.
Where?
Beside the sea.
Beside the sea, that's important. Have you seen that particular coordinate before in the story, you think? Would you talk about that? Alright, we'll have to think about it. In other words, the last time you were at the sea, what happened?
Got some followers.
Go back to the sea, what happens? Gets another sub followers. Must be something about fishing there, huh? Sea followers, alright? So that's important. Sea appears to be, right, once is unique to begins to form a pattern, something about fishing for followers, okay? So we're by the sea, that's the first mini episode.
Goes inside to the tax collector's house.
back into a home.
And there are some outsiders who have some comments.
That's right. Any specific site within that home?
At a meal table.
At a meal table, very important. At table. Okay, good. We're going to come back and we'll look at some of the plot stuff, but right now we're just trying to get a sense of Jesus' movements. Group six, this deputy.
The location is not the time.
Okay, indeterminate location, although there is an implied location, probably. Okay. What might that be? In other words, okay, well, here's an example of the way in which perhaps plot can help construct some of the information around this. What is this story about? Plot line.
About fasting.
And what is fasting? What do you do or not do when you fast?
Stop eating.
You don't eat. And so the implied space here, where do you eat? At home, specifically at table. So the implied space, in a negative sense, is table. Because you're not eating. All right, so we'll kind of put that in parentheses. In other words, this story is about what happens or does not happen at table, so to speak. Okay. All right, group seven.
Where's group seven?
Group seven. Oh,
I'm sure I don't get this memorized, but that's all right.
Group seven. Alphonse, Gaston, please.
Okay, good surprise. Yeah, I think there was a setting of a series of sort of ritual issues leading up.
Where's the setting? A real specific setting in this story.
Cornfield.
Yep, that's exactly right. It takes place in a field.
Yeah, they're wandering through very playfully, sort of plucking ears of corn.
Yep. Okay. So, that's the setting. They're in the field. And finally, in group eight.
They moved from outside into the synagogue.
Back into the synagogue.
And then the group moved outside.
After that episode.
No, at the end of that, sure.
They go out to plot. Yeah, good, okay. All right, so there's, again, an entry and an exit from the synagogue. And, on that. Alright, so we can see now that there's a certain coherence in the frame that starts out synagogue on a Sabbath and ends synagogue on a Sabbath. And in between, we're told that this is a regular sort of circuit in which perhaps maybe this is a a patterned journey. And look what is happening. Synagogue to house. Actually, if we wanted to go before this, it would say, right, wilderness, this is where it starts. Sea, synagogue, home, wilderness, cities are dangerous, home, sea, home, field, synagogue. What world are we getting at here? What do we know about the world based on these settings? About the world of this story.
Jewish
world because of the Sabbath?
Primary industry.
Primary industry meaning?
Meaning fishing and growing crops.
Right. Basic agrarian society in which the productive sites are the ocean in terms of fishing and the field in terms of walking. In other words, it's a basic agrarian society. And the social spaces plotted out here are? That is the places where people are. Homes.
Well, where they are not.
Where they are not. Right. And the basic dialectic here is between synagogue would be public space or private space? Home, public space, or private space? So the basic journey is from the public space of the gathering of the people to the private space of the gathering of the people, and in between there is the productive space of the sea, the productive space of the field,
and the safe space of the wilderness, safe in the sense that it's, Jesus is going there. Now, we're only just putting the pieces of the jigsaw on the table, jigsaw puzzle on the table. Now let's move to characters real quickly. Main characters, we're going to assume that Jesus is a main character all the way through, so the question is, of course, who Jesus is interacting with. In the case of the first one, real quickly.
Disciples, congregation, man with evil spirit, and man's evil spirit itself.
Congregation, a demoniac. Who else?
Well, the disciples are there.
Where are they? Anybody see my New Testament anymore? Seems to have gone missing. No worries.
You want it?
Yeah, it's just because it's got my Greek. I'll check it. There you go.
Well, maybe they are. They can't be burning, but it doesn't say anything about the arguments in the
Bible. Right. So maybe they're there, maybe they're not. This is really typical in Mark. The disciples are kind of always in the background, but sometimes they're specifically stated, sometimes they're not. All right, so you've got the congregation, the them, right, the audience, the demoniac. Any light characters, any indirect characters?
The demon.
Right, the demon, demoniac, the demon. One more character there, pretty important. Very much perhaps describes, yes. Because, as stated in this, let's look at the basic plot conflict. Who's the basic plot conflict between? What? How is that exactly stated in the text? Right, it's a contest between Jesus versus the scribes over the issue being the authority to do what? Authority to teach. When we look at this in more detail, we'll see exactly how this is structured. But that's the essential conflict, which is then also articulated as another conflict between Jesus and the demon. All right, so you have Jesus versus the scribe, Jesus versus the demon. All right, next episodes, characters.
The mother-in-law.
Right? Peter's mother-in-law.
Andrew, James, and John. That's what it's like.
Yeah, this is the first kind of inner circle of disciples. So here specifically some disciples.
There's a whole town.
Right, and then you've got the whole town. Right? Sure you do. Old town.
Demons as well.
Right, lots of demons, lots of healings, kind of generalized statements. Right, but what is the basic plot dynamic in this?
We thought it was interesting that Jesus went immediately to the mother-in-law and touched her.
Right.
That which wasn't normal. Not
right. So it's not so much Jesus versus somebody, but it is Jesus for somebody. So Jesus will use that sign for this mother-in-law. Alright? And that is a particular healing. And then there's some generalized statements that this started to happen. So it's Jesus doing what for who?
Healing many people.
For many people, right? Okay.
And there's also a bit in there where he goes to the wilderness and interact with God.
Right, so this is Jesus really, I think that's important. Jesus doing something about prayer. Prayer doesn't happen much in Mark, so it's important to pay attention to where it does happen. All right. Group three. Yes?
Well, the leper.
Yep.
The priest is mentioned.
Yep.
In reference to Moses.
Yep.
And then there's the town, which Jesus is not able to go to.
Okay.
And the people or the crowd that come to Jesus at the end.
All right. Kind of implied that because of the restricted movement. Is Jesus for or against this leper?
For.
Okay, so doing something for the leper. We're going to get into a lot more detail around these stories. We're just trying to get the basic dynamics now. What about the priest? Is the Jesus and the leper for or against the priest? Now, what's that?
He's affirming the priest's position in that culture as what his task is in relation to the miracle that he performed.
All right, so it would appear, perhaps at first reading, that Jesus and or the leper are affirming the role of the priest. Whether or not that's the case is something we'll have to look at on a closer reading. Group four.
The people are the people of the town.
Yeah.
The people of the town.
So this is actually the first time where the term crowd appears as a particular vocabulary in Mark. It's
one that appears. Scribes were there.
Scribes are very much there. And of course, who's the main character?
And the paralytic with his little group.
Paralytic and friends. Paralytic. All right. There's also a third person persona who's introduced here.
Son of Man.
Right, which, why don't we call the Son of Man the human one, so we can get around some of that exclusionary language, because that is, in fact, what that moniker means. It means the one who is fully human. Okay? So, Jesus' relationship to the paralytic?
He heals him.
So he's for the paralytic?
Yep.
How about the scribes?
They raised questions about his authority.
So that's probably a conflict story.
Yep.
So it's Jesus versus the scribes. Surprise, surprise. Happens a lot. All right. And is there another implied opposition here?
Confronts with a disease.
Yeah, sure. That's the relationship with the paralytic. Right, there is the sin system, and perhaps Jesus' relationship to the sin system. We'll come back and look at that. That's very important. Group five.
The first one is Jesus and the crowd, and then Levi.
Right.
And the people of Levi has his teaching, call,
okay, so we've got discipleship call here. Levi is what? He is what we might call a debt collector. And then the next episode?
We've got the Levi's house and other tax collectors.
Right, so we've got several debt collectors. And they happen to be eating with and sinners, aka those who are in another word for sin. In other words, folks, we got debt collectors and debtors eating together. Alright? Very important. Debt collectors and debtors or sinners. Yeah, and then what we actually have are Pharisaic scribes, or scribes and Pharisees, and so we've got a call. So in other words, Jesus, we could say really in this call, Jesus is for Levi in the sense of calling discipleship. Jesus is for the sinners in the sense of eating with them. And somebody doesn't like that, so it's Jesus versus the Pharisees. Okay. Good. Group six.
Right. Ordinary people asking a question. People, just people.
Yeah, right.
And we've got the disciples of John and the Pharisees.
Right. We've got John's disciples. We've got the Pharisees' disciples. And we have
Jesus'
disciples, right? We got basically three competing groups. All right. What is the essential conflict between who and who?
Jesus refutes the popular assumption that devout people fast.
Right. And it would appear, wouldn't it, that you've got Jesus practiced, and hence his disciples, here, and then you've got at least in the alliance of the common practice is shared by the other two groups. So you've got the John group here and the Pharisaic group here, and this is a conflict story. So you've got a conflict here. All right, group seven.
But Jesus, disciples, Pharisees, David and his men,
yeah.
And the Son of Man, or the human.
All right, you've got the disciples, the Pharisees, you've got the David story, and you've got the human one. Conflict story?
Jesus for the disciples, for David.
Who's the conflict between you?
Well, conflict against the Pharisees.
Jesus versus the Pharisees, and...
and against the law, in a sense.
Who's Jesus' ally?
David.
David versus the Pharisees. That's some pretty impressive ally there, huh? All right? But the dispute is around the what? The practice of
the
Sabbath. So really it is Jesus and David vis-a-vis the Sabbath, and in a sense, Jesus is against one kind of Sabbath and for another kind of Sabbath. All right? It's really important to that story. And finally, we're going to be a little late to lunch, but that's all right. We got through it. Back into the synagogue on the Sabbath, what do we have? Yep, we got, in other words, we got another crowd scene here, another congregational scene.
And off the main stage, the Herodians.
Right. Pharisees and Herodians in alliance. All right. conflict is between who here, really?
Well, there's a sort of unnamed debate, but it's really the Pharisees and Jesus and the... The conflict is about the law and the Sabbath and whether it's appropriate to heal it or do harm in the Sabbath or to. We thought it was a life and death thing, life and destruction.
Sure. Alright. Good. So, now you stand back from all this. Now you put these pieces on the puzzle. Good work. And each group will get a chance now to do some more detailed work around each text as we walk through it as a whole. But what we've done here is we've done a good piece of study. It took us a while. We diversified. That's a good thing to do with groups if you have a big enough group because you have a lot of people working at once. We've read a whole narrative sequence, and look at all the data we have here. We've got a lot of data because we paid attention to some details. And we have found, among other things, that is there a pattern in terms of who Jesus is for and who is against Jesus? What kind of people is Jesus for?
Disadvantaged
people? Outcast people? Debtors?
No.
Hope? We're always crowding around me, right? Kind of a pattern there. What kind of folk are against Jesus? People in authority. Pretty much across the board. You got scribes, you got Pharisees, you got people in positions of power in the synagogue. All you have to do, see, to get the politics of the narrative is to pay attention to the narrative. And it'll tell you what the struggle is over power and authority. It was said very clearly at the beginning, and it's going to be re-articulated time and time again. Friends, good storytellers tell only one story, but they tell it over and over again in lots of different ways. There are some plot dynamics. Let's look at just one of them, just for a second. There is a plot in which, remember that sun going down, group two? Group two, right? Remember the sun going down? What was Jesus doing in the house before the sun went down?
Healing.
What did he do out on the porch of the house after the sun went down? Inside the house, public or private? Outside the house, public or private? Do you see anything in this narrative sequence in which healing publicly on the Sabbath is an issue? Sure, it is the issue that culminates this narrative sequence. So this will
from business about the sun going down and whether you heal in public or private is very crucial. It actually opens up a subplot. The subplot is called, Will Jesus Heal Publicly on the Sabbath? And the tactician Jesus refuses to heal publicly on the Sabbath. He heals privately on the Sabbath, waits for the sun to go down, steps outside, and begins healing publicly. Which shows us two things about Jesus. One, he's attuned to the politics. And two, he's not going to let the politics stop him from healing. But he's going to be strategic about it. That's what's called a subplot that you want to look for. Finally, we could redo this plot to see the correlation between certain spaces and certain people and their relative safety. So, for example, is the Sabbath, is the synagogue a safe space for Jesus in the sense that he is, he's at home there, nobody's attacking him there?
Yeah.
Obviously. Who's in control of the synagogue space? Who appears to be in control? Right, the scribes. The ruling groups, Pharisees, Herodians. Is Jesus on the offensive or the defensive in the synagogue? He's on the offensive and they are on the defensive. Have you come to destroy us? Says the demon. At home, does that seem to be a safe space for Jesus and his disciples? Because every time Jesus is at home, somebody's getting healed, or there's what going on? Table fellowship. See, those are positive coordinates. However, is he occasionally attacked at home?
Yeah.
Right. So, who's attacking him specifically in this episode?
Scribes.
No, for the scribes. Are. So the scribes are on the offensive, and Jesus and his disciples are on the defense. See, this tells you something about these social spaces. Social space in the household is very important for discipleship practice, healing, teaching, and eating. And that's where the discipleship community defends its practice from the authorities, as opposed to the public space in the synagogue, which Jesus is constantly attacking, and they're defending their entitlement. You see the pattern there? And then there's all this other space, which is kind of up for grabs. Wilderness tends to be what kind of space for Jesus? Safe space. The sea seems to be what kind of space for Jesus? Safe space, because that's the call of the disciples. What we're doing here is we're plotting out a real world. And that's important to acknowledge. These stories aren't just about fantasy. They're about real world in which certain groups hold power, other groups are marginalized, and Jesus is taking sides in that world. He's standing with marginalized people, he's contesting public space with the people who control public space, and he's reconstructing an alternative practice in an alternative space, which is the household. In other words, this is all about the social, economic, political practice of the discipleship community in real geography. But we haven't had to study complex sociological formulas to get that. And we haven't had to do heavy political hermeneutics to get that. All we've done is plotted out character and setting and looked at where the essential conflicts are. Which means that anybody in church can do this if we've paid enough attention to the storyline.